Hello, everyone, and welcome to our webinar for the day, Rethinking Economic Inclusion for the Poorest in the COVID-19 Context. This webinar is brought to you by socialprotection.org and BRAC with a number of our partners and colleagues who you will see today. Thank you very much for joining us. As we begin, we'd like to let you know that there are a few upcoming webinars that you may be interested in joining after this. On Thursday, September 10th, we'll have a webinar on gender-based violence and social protection in COVID-19 and beyond. And on Thursday, September 17th, there will be a webinar on linking humanitarian cash and social protection response to COVID-19. Please feel free to join these via registration. There'll be a link posted in the chat box if you're interested, or you can also do that from the socialprotection.org website. As we begin today, you'll see that there are a number of familiar faces, hopefully for some of you on the screen. We wanted to share a bit of what the agenda will be before we go into introducing some of our esteemed panelists. So to start with today, we will have two presenters representing J-PAL who will be sharing research related to economic inclusion, particularly with implications for this COVID-19 context. Then we will move to three of our discussants, which includes two government representatives and a representative from UNICEF. And then we will conclude with question and answer session where everyone will be available to answer any of the questions that arise from the audience. Please feel free throughout this webinar to share your questions in the Q&A box, which you should see at the bottom of your screen. Please, when you do that, note which presenter that you might be including your question for, or if it's for all presenters, and we will be collating and curating those throughout the webinar. And my colleague, Jasmine Pendro, will pull the top questions for us to discuss during the Q&A section later. Please also note that all slides and presentations today will be made available after the webinar. So do not be concerned about taking notes or capturing screenshots of the slides. You will have those available along with the recording. For our presenters today, I will start with myself. My name is Lauren Whitehead. I'm the Director of Technical Assistance for BRAC's Ultra Poor Graduation Initiative. I will be your moderator for today and will be leading us through this webinar with all of our colleagues here present. Our first presenter for today will be Shagun Sabarwal. She's the Director of Policy, Training, and Communications for J-PAL South Asia. Shagun is based in India. Thank you for joining us, Shagun. Our second presenter is Rahma Ali. She's a senior research associate for J-PAL Middle East and North Africa. She is joining us today from Egypt. Thank you as well. And then we have our three discussants. We have Mr. Alex Avila, the Assistant Secretary for the Department of Labor and Employment for the Government of the Philippines. We have Mr. Dalitso Kalimba, who is the Deputy Director of the Department of Economic Planning and Development for the Government of Malawi. And we have Mr. Vincent Gahamanyi, who is the social policy specialist for UNICEF in Rwanda. So thank you very much to our presenters and discussants. You see them all on camera now. We'll start with just a brief overview of why we're here today, what we're hoping to achieve and discuss, and then we'll move right into our presentations. As I mentioned before, please feel free to send your questions in the Q&A box anytime throughout the presentation, just indicating which presenter that those questions are targeted to. So to start today, we wanted to begin with framing this discussion on rethinking economic inclusion during COVID-19. And in particular, we wanted to focus on the graduation approach and other economic inclusion approaches similar to this, and how those programs and approaches can help build economic resilience for households, communities, and countries in the wake of COVID-19. I'm sure it comes as no surprise to any, the wide-reaching impacts in terms of the economic fallout from the pandemic. To date, ILO estimates that as much as 14% of global working hours have been lost, which equates to around 400 million full-time jobs. And that's just by the second quarter of 2020. Among those countries impacted, low-income countries have been the most hardest hit, with around 16% decline in working hours, and an estimate from the World Bank that as many as 70 to 100 million households, 70 to 100 million people will enter extreme poverty in 2020 as a result of the pandemic. We've seen disproportionate impacts of this pandemic between rural and urban populations, which has exacerbated pre-existing conditions and then precipitated new waves of direction that we're seeing for individuals who've been affected by COVID-19. Part of that includes this swell of reverse migration from urban centers into rural areas, primarily due to health concerns from overcrowding, sanitation, and so forth related to the pandemic, but as well as the spate of jobs that have been lost in cities. So part of what we wanted to discuss today was how COVID-19 presents in some ways an opportunity for reinvigorated policy response that will better support the economic resilience and preparation for future shocks for these households. And we wanted to talk you through some of the evidence for why we believe that that might be the case and what some of the outstanding questions are for how governments can best apply a lens towards economic resilience in ongoing efforts in response to the pandemic. By way of framing, we wanted to represent here the graduation approach. For many of you, this might be familiar, but for those for whom it is not, the graduation approach is a holistic approach that encompasses a few different dimensions of need and vulnerability, responds to those needs and vulnerabilities for various households and communities around the world. For BRAC, we recognize four foundational pillars of the graduation approach, specifically through social protection, livelihoods promotion, financial inclusion, and social empowerment. And what we've seen is when these pieces of the graduation approach, when these elements are united and integrated, households are able to build greater resilience, greater preparation for shocks, and therefore recover better from those shocks long term. Some of the key features of graduation that lend themselves to economic resilience in this theme are specifically the market-driven sustainable livelihoods, which households are entered into. I think many might be able to relate to that from other livelihoods programs as well. Graduation additionally layers in strong training in building technical capabilities and skill sets of households so that they're able to respond to adaptive market situations. It helps households identify ways to diversify their assets so they're not just reliant on a single source of income, which we've seen during this pandemic to be quite risky, particularly for those who've lost their livelihoods and then are no longer able to earn and generate income for their families. And then by increasing savings and specifically financial resilience, which I'll speak about in a moment, so that households actually build a cushion for these shocks when they encounter it. These are some of the ex-ante economic resilience factors that we see in graduation that are inherent to the approach and the methodology for bolstering a household's abilities to cope with shocks. But in addition to these economic and financial resilience building features, you have the ongoing life skills training, some form of coaching or ongoing mentorship and support, social empowerment, linkages to health services, community services, and so forth that focus on building the entire well-being of a household. Again, from a holistic perspective, thinking about not just one aspect of how the pandemic or any other crisis might have or might in the future affect the household, but thinking about the household as a holistic unit. And then in turn, thinking about communities from that same perspective. When we think specifically about COVID-19, there are additional elements and key features of many graduation programs that make it a very effective pathway to economic recovery, as we've already seen in a number of contexts. Some of those include the targeted household segmentation, which means that graduation programs have very accurate and up-to-date capture of the profile of households, of the specific vulnerabilities they face, and therefore can be more predictive in forecasting what needs they might have in the wake of a particular crisis. There's also trained frontline staff who act as case managers, as coaches, as mentors, as trainers, and as community resources to households that are empowered to respond quickly, efficiently, effectively, and actually understand the needs of households or communities if they tend to be working at a community level. there's iterative monitoring processes that have inbuilt flexibility to adapt. So adaptation is not an afterthought, is not a secondary concern, but rather a primary feature of programs that are designed to respond to need already. So when a crisis happens, they're able to respond reflexively. Localized market studies allow for the quick reassessment of livelihood strategies, as you'll hear about in some of the programs today, so that those households are better equipped with the knowledge to understand how the market is shifting, even when that's happening at a very rapid pace and at a, in some ways, unpredictable pace, at least so that they can try to stay one step ahead of the curve in preparing for what's to come. Partnerships with local financial service providers protect savings, cushion savings, and provide them with an ability to fall back on some sort of accumulated investment, however small that might be, and then also provides them to resources for accessing other forms of capital as necessary, particularly when a livelihood is hard hit. And then finally, establish linkages with local government and community resources. Part of the aim of graduation is to make households more visible to the services to which they're already entitled but may not be able to access, and to those services which they might not know that they're entitled to and have the ability to then now sue for their rights to access as a result of being a part of these kinds of approaches. I'll just give two very brief examples before we move into our two presenters for today. One example is from Bangladesh. And again, I'll repeat that all of these slides and materials will be made available after the presentation. So I'll just focus on three key takeaways on the left-hand side there that we've seen in Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, the program has been operated for nearly two decades now by BRAC since 2002. And we've seen that in spite of 93% of households experiencing a marked decline in their income during COVID, 95% have continued to engage in income generating activities, mostly for the reasons that I shared before: the diversification of assets, the rapid response in terms of assessing new livelihood strategies, having primary and secondary asset bases, et cetera, so that households did have something to fall back on even when particular parts of their livelihoods were impacted. 96% of households have resumed regular savings, which points to that financial resilience to shocks, so that households had something to fall back on to cushion them at the immediate outset of the crisis. Similarly, if we look in the Philippines, where the government of the Philippines through the Department of Labor and Employment, which our colleague will join us from later today, we've similarly seen impacts of economic resilience in the same fashion, particularly thinking about how 67% of households were able to continue operating their livelihoods even in the midst of a very, very stringent lockdown. Similarly, applying strategies of reassessing livelihoods, reassessing markets, responding quickly, having a direct resource and link to a case manager who can help navigate that process with you. 89% of households were able to keep their assets in full during the COVID-19 pandemic and during the quarantine that ensued. Only 11% of households had either some partial or full loss of their livelihoods, which is quite a small number and far fewer than we would have anticipated. And 75% of households continued to access savings at home after only 29% of households having any kind of savings at the outset of the program. So you see that even in the face of adversity, even in the face of shocks, in both the Philippines and in Bangladesh, just by way of two examples, we're already seeing households bouncing back faster and recovering stronger than we might have anticipated in spite of the crisis taking place. I'll leave you with just a few brief thoughts as we go into our presenters today on ways that graduation and similar economic inclusion approaches might be seen as a viable pathway to economic recovery. Some of the asks that we would make in terms of advancing this going forward would be looking for governments to allocate resources for holistic social assistance that actually incorporates economic resilience building. The initial wave of response that we've seen from governments, understandably, has been focused on emergency relief and needing to meet that emergency need most immediately in the wake of the pandemic. As we move forward and recognize more of the prolonged impacts of the pandemic, particularly from the economic fallout, it'll be critical for governments to look at incorporating economic responses and livelihoods into forward-going packages. We also look at how different governments are at different stages of their development of their social protection systems and their response mechanisms as well, and how that necessitates the need for more tailor-made approaches, recognizing that not every government system is going to be built in the same fashion. Some governments might need to think more about a longer-term roadmap and what the building blocks are on that pathway. Other governments might be better resourced at this particular moment in time to already start incorporating some of these economic approaches. Others might need to employ more innovative models, such as savings first models, that might help households get to a place where they can access livelihoods. All of this we see as part of the customization that happens for every context, for every government, for every ministry and partner that engages in graduation programming. We recognize as well that there is unheard of, unprecedented momentum in the social protection arena that's largely been driven by this need for emergency relief and by this need to distribute things such as cash transfers to wide swaths of the population. But we recognize that this is also an opportunity. It's an opportunity to concretize some of these gains that we're seeing in social protection so that they're not lost after the pandemic, so that we have stronger social protection systems, stronger mechanisms for things such as interministerial collaboration that actually outlasts this pandemic so that we're better suited in the future, whether that means looking at unified registries or that might mean looking at decentralized delivery mechanisms, working with local government and other partners, et cetera. We need to think more about how the systems can be built and maintained to continue after the pandemic. We also look at reassessing graduation program designs. In both of those cases, that, as I mentioned before, in Bangladesh and in the Philippines, rapid iteration of program design was critical in securing livelihoods longer term for those households and was critical in ensuring that those households would have all of their holistic needs continually met through COVID-19 and thereafter. So having a reassessment period that is allowing for adaptive management of livelihoods and adaptive management of risk due to disrupted markets is critical. And the last point that we would mention there is just really advocating for our partners, especially in multilateral institutions. We're working with a number of governments around the world to advocate for and to bolster resources in terms of technical support and financing for shock response and social protection, which we see is going to be increasingly more of the wave of the future if it wasn't already in the past. And that particular type of shock response of social protection actually integrates economic inclusion at the very outset so that we think of it as a forethought and not an afterthought, and we're better prepared for these in the future. So with that, I will go ahead and pause for now so that we can move to our presenters. To start with, I would like to ask our first presenter, Shagun Sabarwal, if she would like to start sharing her screen, and I will stop sharing my screen in this moment. So today, Shagun, we're going to be discussing some of the most pressing challenges in countries where, like BRAC, JPAL, and others are working with the government to elevate research for policy decision-making. That's going to be critical during COVID-19. And what we're looking at today is how this research can help us identify trends and concerns that affect the economic welfare of the poor, and what policy recommendations might be surfaced to governments as a result. So to start with, Shagun, the question I'd like to pose to you is, how has COVID shifted economic realities in Bihar State in India and India more broadly? And why has this illuminated the need for stronger tools of identification for the poorest and the new poor?
Okay, thanks a lot, Lauren. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay, great. So thank you so much, first of all, for organizing this webinar and for also laying this out so clearly. So I found your introduction to be really compelling and ties in really well with what I want to talk about. So just in response to the question that Lawrence has asked me, I would like to, you know, deep dive into what's happening in India and why there is a real need to think about redesigning some elements of the existing social protection system so that they can better speak to the needs that are now emerging since the pandemic. So just to start and just to give a little bit of the context, while COVID-19 is a prolonged public health crisis, and when I use the word prolonged, it really means I want to emphasize the fact that it is evolving in nature. So even from a public health lens, there is a lot of sort of dynamism in the way this crisis is unfolding, whether it is about the concentration of cases moving geographically or about government's response, both at the state level and at the central level. And of course, this has come with a heavy cost to the economy. And I'm sure similar to India, many other countries are also grappling with these economic realities. And then, you know, just at a macro level, we see that, you know, for India, it may take at least 4 years to return to the pre-pandemic levels of growth. But at the same time, governments, both at the central and the federal level, are also facing a kind of a double whammy, because on the one hand, they're tax revenue, and so the revenue streams are kind of drying up, and on the other hand, there is like an acute need to roll out more social assistance programs and expand their safety nets, because more and more people are sort of going through these economic shocks. And then the human face of these macro figures, of course, is the fact that while there are those people who are already poor in India, and here I also want to mention that the fact that while India has seen a lot of economic progress, we have had like tremendous economic growth over the past decade or so, there are deep-seated inequalities that are really, really acute in India. So while, and in fact, there is data that shows that only a very small proportion of the population has really benefited from the huge economic boom that we have gone through. So during times of these crises, it's the people who are already vulnerable, they face many more new economic challenges, and they can get pushed deeper and deeper into poverty. But at the same time, there are these newer groups that are emerging that may not be traditionally poor, but are now facing income shocks, have job losses, and so they are also in need of social protection and social assistance. Finally, I want to say that, you know, one of the things that really emerged for us when this crisis hit was that there is a specific group of people in India who are being consistently failed by the social protection system that exists right now. And this kind of spurred a huge movement in thinking about redesigning the current system. And this is the group of people of urban migrants. And I'm sure a lot of you, this may be happening in many more developing countries as well. This is definitely a phenomenon where people migrate often from rural areas to urban areas to find work. But this migration is temporary in nature. It may be seasonal in nature. And their families are typically back home, you know, in the rural areas. But when they come to cities, they really have no formal mechanisms through which governments can reach them. They don't have housing. They don't have access to food. And so when the pandemic hit and there was a great lockdown that was announced, it was these people whose sort of plight was extremely worrying and disturbing. And they had no option but to kind of rush back home, despite that we didn't even have proper transport at that time. But the fact was that there was nothing for them in the cities that could allow them to survive once their income sources stopped. And here are some sort of statistics that, you know, were kind of some data that was collected by an NGO that works with this particular group. Now I want to like kind of take a step back and go back to the point that Lauren had been making, which is to say that this crisis has also highlighted for us the very, very crucial nature, the social protection systems or the institutions or the governance mechanisms around social protection play. And for us, I think what has been really fortunate is that during the pre-COVID times, the Indian successive governments in India, both at the central and the state level, had been making huge investments to lay down the building blocks of the social protection system, whether it was increasing the number of people who they can reach, whether it was increasing the new types of programs and platforms, or the G2P, which is government to persons type of systems, including banking the unbanked people, having an infrastructure for direct benefit transfers, moving away from in-kind transfers to cash transfers for some of these things. So all of this really helped us during the time of crisis. And while the government announced this big package as a relief package, the government basically used these existing platforms to expand the access and benefits to a large number of people, which sort of makes more sense because there's no time during an emergency response to build new systems. So this kind of really speaks to the importance of investments in social protection institutions. Now, here I would like to kind of go back to the introduction that Lauren had given, where she had talked about graduation approach. And while graduation approach in and of itself is an extremely powerful pathway that speaks to the unique needs of a particular group of households, especially the ultra poor households who are not able to benefit from the formal social protection systems that the government may have in place. So of course we all know how the graduation approach can be extremely empowering. But I want to also highlight that in a crisis like this, if governments have the graduation approach as a formal part of their social protection system, then this will also allow the governments to really reach this really marginalized group or this sort of invisible group. So here I wanted to kind of zoom in a little bit on our experience in the state of Bihar. So as many of you know, Bihar is a state in India, which is one of the third most populous state in the country with a population of 126 million people. The state continues to face a number of challenges when it comes to its human development indicators. And even though the government has been doing a lot of things, it still continues to have a substantial population of poor and ultra poor households in the state. So one of the things that JPAL has been doing has been talking to governments and especially states which have a lot of ultra poor population to think about the graduation approach as being one of the pathways that can be uniquely designed for this group of people. And in 2018, it was a really great moment for us when the government of Bihar decided to launch the graduation approach in the form of SJY scheme to reach 100,000 households, and they were themselves implementing the scheme. So this is the first time in India and maybe even globally where the government is directly implementing this approach at such a large scale. And to date, 100,000 ultra poor households have been identified and approximately 39,000 have already received their productive assets. So just to also acknowledge that there is a partnership between Jivika, which is the body from the government side that's implementing this program, Bandhan Konagar, which is an NGO that's providing technical assistance to the government, and Bandhan Konagar has been implementing the graduation approach, and JPAL South Asia, and we are playing the knowledge and learning partner role by doing a process evaluation and a randomized evaluation of the scale-up. But what I want to emphasize here is that when the crisis hit, the government of Bihar use the SJY database to send 2,000 rupees immediately stipend to the SJY participants and to also make push these calls to these participants. And why I think this is really remarkable is because the counterfactual is that if we had not had this particular program, it would have been really difficult for the government to reach to these really, really vulnerable group of people who would have been really affected by the pandemic as is. So just to sort of kind of use this opportunity, we then decided to also undertake a telephonic survey because of course our field operations were, could not be happened. They were suspended at that time. And what we did was that we quickly sort of did these phone surveys with the SJY beneficiaries. And just to have a rough comparison group, we also called other women who are not members or who are not recipients of the scheme, but were a part of the other self-help groups. And basically we collected data on a range of different indicators, but in the interest of time, I'll just highlight a few. So what we basically find is that both of the SJY and the SHG households knew about COVID symptoms were aware about COVID-19, but when you really think about their ability to recall symptoms of COVID-19, then we found that those who were the SJY beneficiaries were statistically significantly more likely to not be able to recall symptoms of cough, cold, sneezing, and fever. So this highlighted the fact that the government needs to do a little bit more to create awareness specifically among this group. We also, we also asked them questions around coping mechanisms for economic shock. And what we find again here, which is a little bit worrying, is that as compared to the SHG members, the SJY participants were more likely to reduce the number and size of meals as a coping strategy. And they were also more likely to borrow food or ask for help. And now we are planning more follow-up surveys with the same group to find out how this has impacted their the SJY program itself. Now I would like to zoom back a little bit again to really go back to some of the questions that Lauren had left us with, which is to say that, okay, you know, what do we now do when we are thinking about from the lens of economic inclusion, when we are thinking about our social protection systems? So for India, at least, there are some key challenges that have emerged. So the one that I would like to specifically highlight here, first of all, is that India has made tremendous progress, like I said, in its social protection kind of system. And they were also able to quickly scale up a lot of these programs during the emergency response. But we are increasingly realizing that it is really skewed towards rural areas. And this has left urban households particularly vulnerable. We also find that 80%, 5% of the labor force in India is informal, which is a barrier to effective distribution of benefits. They don't have records. And so it's, again, very difficult for governments to reach out. They don't have a formal database. The third important point, which again we have quickly sort of revised, is that most of the benefits were tied to a person's place of residence. So like I said, their ability to avail a lot of benefits was tied to their identity card, which was based at their location. And this again led to a lot of problems where migrants were not able to access food. But now this has been changed and the government has rolled out like a particular One Nation, One Card, where people are able to use that card to access food from various fair price shops anywhere across India. So this is a big thing that's happened directly as a result of what happened in the pandemic. And finally, there is this problem of reaching out those who don't have identification cards or those who are not, who were previously not availing the benefits, but may now need to do that. So I would like to end my presentation by just highlighting some of the evidence that JPAL-affiliated researchers have been producing from over the years and how some of those evidence-based insights could be used as we are thinking about designing a new sort of a social protection system. So the first is, and as Lauren also mentioned, there is a need to have a more flexible and dynamic social protection system that can also include those who are not traditionally poor, but are suffering from income shocks currently, and moreover, a system that you can kind of switch on and off during times. But at the same time, it's also important to think about targeting, because even with a lot of this sort of development that's happened in the whole social protection system, we still have problems of exclusion errors. So there are certain approaches over and above the traditional approaches, such as proxy mean tests, etc., which look at more sort of long-term indicators of poverty, to look at other targeting approaches, such as community-based targeting or even self-targeting. So those are some of the things that could be incorporated. Then there's also a lot of discussion around universal transfers. And while UBI is one end of the spectrum, there is also, some of the economists are also thinking about income transfers that are, say, pegged at 1% of a country's GDP, but making that transfer universal. And this is something that the economist Kartik Muralidharan has been talking about. Secondly, we also definitely need an urban corollary of large rural safety net programs that can be scaled up quickly during crisis. I've also talked about housing. So a lot of the state governments, especially the governments from the receiving states who receive a lot of these urban migrants, are really thinking about the need for having housing that the migrant workers can rent out, or providing some such mechanisms. And finally, I would like to end by saying a little bit about digitization. And while this is a fantastic opportunity for us to think about digitization with this whole idea of social distancing and masks, you know, sort of using, not going physically to sort of draw cash, it's really important to think about direct mobile money and things like that. And while this is great, it's also equally important to really go into the details when designing these systems, because once a system is designed, it becomes really difficult to change it. And there is evidence from JPAL which shows that depending on the state's administrative capacity, and there are some states that may not have, that may have more weaker sort of, delivery institutions. It's really, really important that the sort of the devil is in the details. So we have to look at details. We have to make sure that this digitization does not end up systematically excluding certain people. And we have to make sure that that happens. So I would like to end here. And thank you so much. And I'm looking forward to the discussion and the questions. So I will stop my screen now.
Thank you so much, Shagun. Thank you very much. I think there were a lot of key themes there that you mentioned, similar to the things that echoed what I was mentioning before and what other presenters will mention on identification, looking specifically at how we're identifying the ultra poor, the group that's typically invisible, typically left behind, thinking particularly about the new poor. I really like when you're talking about the corollaries to social protection systems for rural systems and how that can be brought into urban areas especially. And I think we'll hear a little bit on that from our discussants later as well. And then you also mentioned in the vein of talking about migration, housing, which I think is an interesting area that doesn't often get spoken about, not as much as it should necessarily when we're talking about social assistance. So thank you for bringing those up. I'll go ahead and ask Rahma if you would like to go ahead and start sharing your screen for the next part. And I'll pose the question to Rahma as we begin. So Rahma will be presenting from Egypt, also representing JPAL. Rahma, at the start of the pandemic, as we know in many countries, rural livelihoods in Egypt appeared to fare better than urban and peri-urban livelihoods, at least at the outset, because those livelihoods were more heavily dependent on markets and demand that decreased during lockdown and global trade flows. So how has the pandemic expanded to now impact those rural livelihoods, especially for women's labor force participation? And what do you think there are lessons that might be shared with governments to actually help safeguard some of the progress that we've seen for women's labor force participation in the MENA region? So thank you very much, Rahma.
Thank you very much, Lauren. I assume that you can see my screen and hear my voice?
Yes, we can.
Okay, welcome everyone. I'm happy to be here today to share with you some insights on the status of the ultra poor in Egypt during the COVID-19 pandemic. Let me start first by giving some background on the organization that myself and my colleague Shagun represent today. So we both belong to JPAL, Abdel Latif Jamil Poverty Action Lab, which is a global research center with a mission to reduce poverty by ensuring that policy is informed by evidence and research is translated into action. This is done through our seven regional offices and hundreds of local partnerships that ensure that JPAL is locally grounded. And I'm happy to share with you that the regional office that I belong to has just been recently officially launched at the American University in Cairo, which is the Middle East and North Africa office. And although we were just recently launched, our work in the region goes back to 2015. Our network of affiliates has carried out more than 1,000 randomized evaluations in countries around the world. And today I'm leveraging one randomized evaluation that is conducted in Egypt to study the impacts of COVID-19 pandemic. And this has been possible thanks to our strong local partnerships in the field. So without further ado, let me give you some background on the program that's being evaluated, which is BEB AMAL program. So BEB AMAL is an adaptation of the graduation approach that Lauren talked about a little bit in the beginning, that was first designed by BRAC to build sustainable livelihood and resilience among 2,400 ultra-poor households in Upper Egypt. Both the program and the evaluation are funded by the Sawiris Foundation for Social Development and is being implemented in two of the poorest governorates, the two poorest governorates in Egypt, Suhaig and Asyut, through our local implementers, two local NGOs. The first one is Giving Without Limits Association in Asyut, and the second one is Egyptian Human Development Association based in Suhaig. So the impact evaluation does not only measure the impact of the standard graduation program, but it goes beyond to explore impacts on one variation that is women targeted only, and the other variation that is offered at a much reduced cost, at a half cost of the standard program. The program actually started last year with a fully fledged targeting exercise and to be able to recruit the participating households, and the interventions were offered on rolling basis starting in November 2019. After the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic, the Egyptian government has issued a number of measures that I'm going to go very briefly and explain to you. At first, in mid-March, a partial lockdown was enforced, and it started to ease gradually in late June. During that time, shops and commercial centers remained open until only 6 p.m. and sometimes until 5 p.m. Also, during this time, a nationwide curfew was enforced from 8 p.m. To 6 a.m. in the following morning. A national study conducted by the Central Agency for Public Mobilization and Statistics reports that about 74% of Egyptian families seeing declining incomes, which is something within the same declining pattern that Lauren was speaking about in her introduction. And we've also, in the same study, about 56% of the sampled individuals reported working fewer hours. So during this time, the research team at JPL started a rapid assessment to follow up on the households of the BEB ML program during the pandemic. And again, due to worldwide lockdown and suspension of all field work at JPL, the data for this survey was collected via phone. The data collection started in May, and it's still being ongoing until now. And during this time, we're able to sample around 840 households, split almost evenly between the two governorates where the program is implemented. And it's important to mention that all the sample households by that time had received their livelihood assets for a period ranging between 3 and 10 months. So let me tell you a bit about the livelihood asset types that these households receive. So they get to choose an asset between two categories, livestock or non-livestock asset. And we see that the majority or 80% of the sample opted for a livestock asset. Examples of livestock assets are breeding goats, breeding sheep, and poultry. A small percentage of 20% opted for non-livestock assets, such as grocery, selling ready-made garments and selling fodder, or having a sewing machine to make clothes. When asked about their livestock asset revenues during the pandemic, only 26% of the sample reported that they were able to generate revenues from their assets during the pandemic. And we also see that non-livestock asset households were more likely to generate revenue. And when for those who, for the household that were not able to generate any revenues, 80% of the livestock asset groups reported that they did not have anything to sell because the offsprings of their assets have not yet matured to be sold and bring in revenue. And this brings us back to the point that these households have had their assets for just 3 to 10 months period. For the non-livestock asset households, they reported that there was little supply and also little demand on their products. Now, as you can see, all of this is another indication of a shock in household income. And one coping strategy that we were able to capture in this survey is borrowing money or spending from savings. And we see here that livestock households borrowed or spent money from their savings a little bit more than non-livestock households. And these households mostly use their savings to buy food or to mitigate health shocks. Now here, I'd like to highlight that it's not 100% clear whether these health shocks are COVID-19 related or not. However, our local implementers did not report any COVID-19 positive cases within our sample of households. Another aspect that we've been able to capture in this survey is the pattern in food consumption for these households. So we see that there has been a decline or a decrease in food consumption for about 40% of the whole sample. And we see also again that livestock households are more likely to have a reduction or a decrease in their food consumption than non-livestock households. And when asked about the reason, the most prevalent reason for the decrease in food consumption is attributed to a decrease in income. Next, I move on to an individual level aspect, which is unemployment. The data shows that there is an increase in unemployment compared to baseline. At baseline, which was pre-COVID-19 pandemic, unemployment rates were at 3% among males and 8% among females. However, now we see these rates have jumped to 36% among males and 76% among females. And here by work, I mean any income generating activity, whether done inside the house or outside the house, within a formal establishment or outside of the establishment. The main criterion here is that it is an income generating activity. And then the most frequent changes that these individuals reported regarding their employment is a reduction in their work time and also a reduction in the income. So what can we really take away from these points? I'm here going to leave you with two main thoughts. The first one is related to the livelihood asset type that is offered to these households as part of their graduation package. Households with non-livestock assets are more likely to generate revenue than households with livestock assets. And here it's important to highlight that the nature of the livestock asset requires some time before the household is able to sell their offsprings of their assets and make revenue. So the cycle of the livestock assets take a little bit longer to generate revenue than non-livestock assets, which seems to be a disadvantage in such stressful and economically challenging time, which is the COVID-19 pandemic. Next, we'll be able to observe qualitatively that households with livestock assets tend to diversify their businesses by incorporating a non-livestock component that is fast revenue generating after selling the first cycle, which means that non-livestock assets were sought more frequently during the pandemic. Next, we've seen that livestock asset households reduce their food consumption more than non-livestock asset households, and this can be attributed to decrease in income and inability to generate revenue during the pandemic. And again, I would like to highlight that these results are based on a relatively short-term exposure to the program interventions. As I mentioned before, these households have kept on their assets for a period between 3 to 10 months, and which is a relatively short term. And these months include the 3 months of the nationwide lockdown and the peak of the pandemic in Egypt. And perhaps results from longer term exposure might show different patterns. The second and final point that I'm going to leave you with today is related to female labor market participation. So these households are coming from economically vulnerable status at baseline, and we've seen how the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted both males and females. However, it has impacted females much more than males in terms of reducing work time. Another point that we've also been able to observe qualitatively from the field that with increased unemployment for males, we've seen a phenomena which is not exclusive to our communities, but also something that has been reported universally, which is an increase in frictions among couples inside the household. And this this is happening along with increased unemployment for males and having males stay at home more often than before. And this is especially true for the household where they have a female main beneficiary who is running the asset and the business. And with this, I finish my presentation, and I'm happy to receive your questions and for the discussion afterwards. Thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you so much, Rahma. That's fantastic to hear, even in spite of some of the disappointing results thus far. But I think, as you mentioned, one thing that's important to recognize is that we're at the early onset of the program interventions in Bab Amal. And I think given the technical assistance that BRAC has been working with the partners on and with JPAL and others, we're hoping that as the program moves and can take more root for those households, that we're able to reverse some of those trends over time. But I think what that also speaks to is something we were talking about earlier with regards to the need for building and investing in these kinds of economic inclusion approaches early on before a crisis sets, so that households are actually able to get to that point of stability as they're moving into a crisis. So thank you so much for that. And then that last point actually that you mentioned, not only thinking about the importance of the type of assets, but then thinking about how those assets play out at the household level in terms of women's labor force participation, which I think our discussants will echo a bit on later, because there's quite a bit of concern that COVID has disproportionately impacted women's livelihoods and might continue to do so. So how can we safeguard some of the progress that we've seen in that area in the face of the pandemic? So thank you very much for giving that overview. And I'm sure we'll have lots of questions for you next. So I'll go ahead and share my screen one more time now as well as we move forward to our discussants. So as I mentioned earlier, we have three discussants who are joining us today from various different, representing various different governments and then also UNICEF. So we have Mr. Alex Avila from the government of the Philippines. We have Mr. Dalitso Kalimba from the government of Malawi and Mr. Vincent Gahamanyi from UNICEF Rwanda. So if I can invite my discussants to please turn on your cameras, that would be wonderful. And we can go ahead and move into the next portion of our webinar today. Again, as we mentioned, all of the slides that were presented today, as well as the bios for each of the discussants and the presenters will be made available to everyone after the webinar is done. Okay, so just to start today, we'd like to pose the first question to Mr. Avila. We know that in the Philippines, the Department of Labor and Employment has executed a graduation program targeting beneficiaries in Negros Occidental province with Asian Development Bank. We also recognize, given your particular position, that you sit at a unique role watching how Dole is similarly facing an influx of these returned overseas workers and migrants, much to the theme that Shogun mentioned earlier when she talked about the challenges facing the government in Bihar. What we'd like to know from you today is how has Dole responded to help integrate these returnees into economic opportunities as they become available? And perhaps specifically, how is Dole's integrated livelihoods program through Kabuhayan and other features and Tupad's emergency employment program been mobilized for the local workforce that has lost their jobs during the pandemic? So I'd like to invite Mr. Avila to speak first.
Thank you, Lauren, and thank you for this opportunity to participate in this webinar. I think it is important for me to frame my response within the following context. First, before the pandemic restricted international travel and outmigration early this year, the stock of documented Filipino migrant workers was estimated at 3.39 million, and undocumented OFWs stood at 1.55 million. Of the little over 2 million workers deployed overseas in 2019, more than 1.5 million were land-based, and 467,000 were sea-based. Second, the government began repatriation of overseas Filipino workers in February. The Department of Foreign Affairs was reported last week as saying that some 177,000 distressed OFWs are still waiting to return home. The government has said that it is committed to bring home every Filipino who wants to return home. Third, the Philippines is said to have implemented the longest lockdown so far, starting on March 16 and running through this day, with lockdown degree shifting every 15 days. And finally, the July 2020 round of the labor force survey released this morning indicated that 4.6 million Filipinos had lost their jobs, or an unemployment rate of 10%. Business closures, whether permanent or temporary, especially among micro, small, and medium enterprises, have been reported in sectors hardest hit by restrictions, such as tourism, retail trade, manufacturing, travel and transportation, and construction. So, this is the context of the Dole's response to the twin challenge of reintegrating tens of thousands displaced OFWs in the domestic economy, which has seen unprecedented job losses and business closures. As of August 31, the Philippine government has facilitated the return of nearly 175,000 repatriated overseas Filipino workers to their home communities. On average, each of the 81 provinces in the Philippines has so far absorbed additional 2,161 residents who are without jobs and source of regular income, which for so long have sustained economic dynamism and growth. Tens of thousands of displaced migrant workers have returned home and will continue to return to communities which could barely operate socially and economically as a result of the running lockdowns imposed to contain the COVID-19 pandemic. The government's first response has been to provide immediate financial relief to affected and displaced migrant workers, whether they are still overseas or already in the country. Of course, for those returning, the government's priority is to ensure their orderly and safe return, which encompasses RT-PCR testing, quarantine, and ultimately transportation to their home communities. The greater challenge, without doubt, is how to successfully integrate a large number of repatriated OFWs into a struggling economy, harness their skills and talents toward economic recovery, and in the process, somehow create in the local environment the conditions that motivate or even compel Filipinos to work overseas in the first place. It is not easy to contemplate effective reintegration in a situation where health concerns dictate personal and government actions that restrict movement of people and consumers and the production of exchange of goods and services considered non-essential. To some, it is a case of the law of self-preservation in motion, and perhaps to others, it's no doubt a catch-22 situation. So the expanding economic opportunities for migrant workers at home has always guided the government's reintegration program. But while the pandemic has created conditions which have narrowed economic options for OFWs, it has at the same time opened up spaces where their skills and overseas experience could be put to good use and productive undertakings can be pursued. I think as some of you know, the Dole through the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration and the National Reintegration Center for OFWs have existing livelihood programs for returning OFWs. And as part of our response to integrate them into the economy, the DOLE and OWA will implement this month a livelihood program for organized OFWs that will support startup undertakings, help expand existing businesses, or even restore those which have suffered financial setback during the crisis. Focus will be on high impact and high value projects, including those that will benefit marginalized sector, including migrant women returnees. And to ensure viability and to support key employment generating sectors, this livelihood program will focus on agribusiness, information technology, health and wellness, wholesale and retail trade, tourism, and the like. This means that livelihood projects will have to support the production of priority products and other agriculture-based products, among others. The idea really is to align entrepreneurial undertakings along the requirements of the new normal in a post-pandemic environment where not only rules, but demographics and markets have changed. On the other hand, the DOL has implemented emergency employment program for workers in the informal economy who lost their jobs and sources of income during the lockdowns. Enrolled by the DOLI in the Bayanihan to Recover as One Law or Bayanihan Law, the tulong panghanap buhay sa ating disadvantaged or displaced workers or TUPAD is a community-based safety net program that provides temporary wage employment to workers in the informal sector, such as the self-employed, on-account workers, unpaid family workers, including ambulant or market vendors. As I speak, more than 423,000 informal sector workers benefited under TUPAD, with 1.59 billion pesos paid to the beneficiaries. And under the proposed Bayanihan 2 bill, which is up for signing by the President, the DOLE will continue to implement emergency employment program with budgetary allocation of 5 billion pesos or roughly 100 million US dollars to benefit around 800,000 informal sector workers who will render community work for 15 days. But as a final note, and going back to the challenge of how best to integrate returning OFWs into the domestic economy through livelihood programs, and recalling our initial experience with the ongoing pilot implementation of the graduation approach in the province of Negros, there are at least four elements of graduation that I think our livelihood program should possess. First is the necessity of having community facilitators or their equivalents in sufficient number and with appropriate resources to lead project implementation and management. Second is the family development plan, which includes mentoring and coaching, which ideally should be part of the business plan so that our beneficiaries can be made to prepare to manage their projects well and ensure viability and sustainability. Of course, as we have experienced in Negros and our other livelihood projects, multi-stakeholder partnership is a must. And finally, and I cannot overemphasize this in view of the pandemic, we really need to have regular and real-time monitoring and evaluation using internet-based technology. Loran noted in her opening presentation that based on the June evaluation of the pilot implementation of the graduation approach in Negros, it was found that 2 out of 3 beneficiaries were able to continue operating their livelihoods during the lockdown. 9 out of 10 beneficiaries were able to keep their assets. And 3 out of 4 beneficiaries were able to continue accessing savings at home. The pilot implementation, I think, is, as I understand, this is wrapping up this month. And we are really very happy to know these results. I hope that graduation approach could somehow be also inspire the implementation of our livelihood program for our repatriated OFWs, and we hope to see similar results out of these livelihood projects. So thank you very much.
Wonderful. No, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Asik Avila. It's wonderful to hear those to hear that feedback as well, particularly underscoring some of the key elements that we've talked about related to graduation in terms of case management, in terms of monitoring, in terms of the importance of having families invested in their own development plans as they're moving through. And I think to what you were mentioning for the OFWs, the overseas workers, it resonates with what Shogun mentioned earlier around the double whammy of recognizing that there's fewer resources coming in from tax bases, yet an expanded need. And that in addition to that, you're dealing with a unique situation of very highly skilled laborers who are coming back and then looking for work, and then how to actually match them to available opportunities, creating opportunities, you mentioned in agribusiness, in IT and health and so forth, to utilize their skills, recognizing that the investment that the government of the Philippines will have to make is significant, and is of course going to be a challenge with dwindling tax bases. So thank you very much for the overview from that. I think what we'll do now is maybe move to our next discussant from Malawi, Mr. Dalitso Kalimba. So we know that currently the government of Malawi is working in partnership with IFAD, the International Fund for Agricultural Development, to implement the Financial Access for Rural Markets, Smallholders, and Enterprises program, FARMSE, which is a graduation program that's being executed in Malawi. So Mr. Kalimba, would you like to share with us a bit of how the government is using cash transfer specifically for urban populations in the wake of COVID, and how the government is able to address this need for serving an expanded base, which is something I think that Mr. Avila was just speaking about as well in the Philippines.
Yeah, thank you, Lorraine, for giving us the opportunity to contribute to this very important discussion. Thanks to the two presenters, Shagun and Rahma. It was very interesting presentations that we heard. And to my colleague as well from Philippines, Alex. It was nice hearing from you in terms of what you're doing in your country. I'll first provide a bit of a broader context in terms of the situation on the ground in Malawi, starting with the pre-COVID. In Malawi, we did an assessment. And actually, there are a number of assessments that will be done when the pandemic came. And the assessment was on the economic impact and other impacts on the population. And what is coming out clear is that the COVID has affected everybody, the entire population. But I think similar to the experience in Egypt, in terms of livelihoods, it has affected the urban more than the rural. And we also note that before COVID, the percentage of the poor in urban areas was about 38%. But then COVID has affected these poor, but it has also brought in the new poor. I think in terms of the difference in terms of impact, rural urban, I think it's mostly attributed to the fact that in Malawi, in rural areas, livelihoods are predominantly agri-based. Whereas in urban areas, I think there's a lot of the dependence on the market in terms of livelihoods. So the impact is more felt in the urban areas than in the rural areas. In terms of the interventions that were there before COVID came in, social protection. I think the biggest program has been the social cash transfer program, which is covering the entire country or districts, but it covers the rural areas only. So we haven't had the social cash transfer program in the urban areas, especially the cities. Now, when COVID came, we had a big challenge in terms of how we have to address the issue of the urban areas. For the rural areas, the direction was a bit clear because we have beneficiaries of cash transfers who are there. And basically the decision, the first one was to do some vertical expansion in terms of the transfer levels, just increase or top up the transfer levels to enable them cope with the COVID the effects of the COVID, I think specifically in terms of the restrictions that have been introduced to curb COVID. For Malawi, we haven't had a lockdown yet. So basically what is happening is just the restrictions, but without a lockdown. Now, we decided as a government that for the urban dwellers, we have to introduce an emergency cash intervention. Basically, it was meant to target the 38% that are poor, but as indicated, that we also have the new poor within the urban areas. These new poor, our understanding is that actually the ones that are already poor, if you look at their characteristics, most of them were the ones that were doing petty trading and the ones that were in formal employment, and most of it is very temporary. But the new ones mostly come from a loss of jobs. And I think from the assessments that were done, the economic impact of COVID in Malawi, it's very clear that the service sector was hardly hit in terms of the effect. And there's the food and accommodation subsector, which is the hotels, restaurants, etc. That one is been the most affected. And it has resulted in loss of jobs, as well as scaling down of operations, as well as of closure of businesses. So for the urban, the intervention that we are about to implement, it hasn't yet commenced. Basically, primarily is supposed to assist the people that are already poor. Maybe the challenge that we have is that it may not be adequate for those that were not poor before, because this is basically a cushion. The cash transfers will be provided for about 3-4 months. This may not suffice for those that were already in jobs. So maybe the biggest task that we have is how do we assist those that are described as the new poor. Probably what they need is some sort of bailout to resuscitate some businesses, etc., so that we maintain jobs in the process. So basically that is briefly what we are doing with regard to the urban intervention. The rural intervention is primarily the vertical expansion of the transfers increasing, but we are also still having a discussion on increasing the numbers, though that were not on the program before, could be added temporarily just to cut off the effects of the COVID. Now, with respect to lessons learned, I think already as we're designing the urban cash intervention, we have come to notice one thing, that it is very critical that in any intervention of this nature, we need to have a coordinated response, coordinated in terms of multi-sector, as well as pulling efforts from government, development partners, NGOs, and other non-state actors for us to have meaningful impact, because the needs of the affected population are many, and they may not be just addressed by addressing one dimension. Then we are also seeing the need for undertaking meaningful linkages to other services that are available. For example, the social cash transfer beneficiaries could be linked to livelihood interventions. And I think this brings me now to a bit of discussion on the what we're doing on graduation. For graduation, basically, it's new in Malawi, but we have some programs that are going on. And the major one, of course, is FAMZE, that is targeting about 17,000 households. And with the coming of COVID, I think there's been a lot of impact in terms of the expectation, in terms of the graduation of the participants on the program. But beyond that, we also have issues to do with the delivery itself, the implementation of the interventions. I think as was presented by Lorraine, I think in terms of what is contained in a graduation program, I think there's a component on social empowerment, basically where there's coaching and mentoring, and that is a very interactive process between a caseworker and a household. With COVID, the social distancing physical distancing, it is very difficult for implementing partners to undertake effective coaching and mentoring, because you're supposed to grow the bond between the caseworker and the beneficiary. We also note that the financial inclusion aspect, the savings in terms of the modalities that we've been using, it's not feasible for teams or groups to be meeting and doing business as they used to. But it's also an opportunity for us to see how we can innovate modalities for delivering graduation to achieve the same while being innovative. I think we have also noted that the coming of COVID has distorted some of the value chains. We now have new value chains. Selection of an enterprise is an issue in any graduation program, and we're seeing new crops, variable crops emerging. And I think that is also an opportunity for us to redirect our investments within the farms. I think briefly, that's what I can say for now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kalimba. Thank you. That's very, very helpful. And I think that actually connects us well to our last discussant before we move to the Q&A, which is from Mr. Gahamanyi, who's going to represent from the government of Rwanda. And I think one thing that Mr. Kalimba was just mentioning regarding coordinated responses and linkages across partners, particularly given some of these new challenges, not just for graduation, but especially thinking about informal workers in urban areas. So Mr. Gahamanyi, if we can ask you to turn on your camera. The question that we'd like to pose to you today is, how has the government of Rwanda responded to COVID-19 in terms of safety nets and economic inclusion? And how is UNICEF working as a coordinated partner with the government on those recovery mechanisms? And if you could speak a bit to the disproportionate impact on women's labor force participation and any responses that might be geared towards them, that'd be wonderful. And then we'll close with a few questions for today. Are you there? Do we have Mr. Gahamanyi, Vincent? Okay, we may have had a connectivity issue. Okay, we may have had a connectivity issue for Mr. Gahamanyi. So in the interest of time, we might go ahead and move towards the audience questions, and then we'll come back to him if he's able to connect. Oh, are you there? Yes, okay, I think we may have lost him. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll go ahead and move into the questions and answers. So I thank my colleagues who've been helping to compile some of those. Oh, hello? Yes. Hi, there we go.
Hello?
Hi, Vincent, can you hear us?
Hello?
Yes, hello. Can you hear us?
Hello?
No, I don't think he can hear us very well. So I'll ask my colleagues to maybe communicate with him to let him know, and we'll go ahead to the Q&A for right now. So the first question that's been posed in the Q&A is actually directed to Shagun for your presentation earlier, which is, what is the best or most cost-effective way to reach out to people who are not currently covered by social protection mechanisms? And what have you learned, particularly in India, in this regard? So if I could ask Shogun if you might give a 1-minute response to that, that'd be perfect.
Sure. Unfortunately, there is sort of no silver bullet answer to say, well, this is the best way to identify. And like I had mentioned, a lot also depends on the administrative capacity of state governments to kind of really roll out a program, because on the planning side, things may look fantastic. So even in India, which has sort of had this entire drive towards a unique identification that each and every person in India is supposed to have, we still find a lot of gaps. right? And then there's also was also this movement where the government was thinking of just doing away with sort of in-kind transfers and moving everything to direct benefit transfer systems. And for certain particular sort of union territories where we did some independent research, we find that in the government database, you may say 100% of the people have been included in the DBT. But when we did the surveys on the field, we realized 1/3 of the households reported not receiving the benefits, right? So there is always this disconnect, even in the data that the government thinks everything has happened and there's still exclusion. So coming back to identification, I would like you to kind of look at the work that Ben Olken and Rima Hana have been doing with respect to targeting, and they have actually done some fantastic work in Indonesia, where they have really shown, where they have really compared different forms of targeting to see which one is the one that has the most reach. And here they are, even in the COVID times, are recommending moving away from the traditional methods of proxy means testing to looking at things like community-based targeting or self-targeting. So I would say that you should look into that as one of the options.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you so much, Shagun. And Vincent, does it look like you're back there again? Can we hear you now?
Yes.
Yes, okay, wonderful. Okay, so we'll go ahead back to the question that was posed to you originally, which is particularly related to the support from UNICEF working with the government in terms of the COVID response. Did you want to go ahead and speak for a moment on that?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Laura, for the presentation you made, and thanks to all the presenters and discussants in economic inclusion for the poorest in the COVID context. When I come back now to the Rwanda context, when there was a COVID outbreak, Rwanda quickly took a decision to have a lockdown, unlike maybe Malawi that did not have a total lockdown. Rwanda had a total lockdown, and there were a lot of restriction measures put in place to protect people from getting COVID. Of course, during this lockdown, people had challenges, mainly those people were casual laborers, and those who were, was most of the economic activities were not active by them. So as a result of that, the government...
Vincent, I think maybe your connection is breaking up. If you wanted to cut off your video, that's perfectly fine.
Distributing food to people who are, sorry?
If you want to cut off your video, it might help with the bandwidth a bit. Yeah.
Okay.
Great, are you still there? Oh no, I think it looks like you might have frozen. Can you still hear us? No? Okay. Okay, I think we might have lost Vincent again there. The perils of technology. So what we will do is, maybe we'll go ahead and move to another question from the Q&A, and then hopefully third time's the charm, and we'll get Vincent to come back to us there. Okay, so one of the questions... Oh, yes, are you there? I think the connection is going out a bit. Can you speak again? We can partially hear you. Maybe if you want to start trying, and then I'll let you know if we can't.
I'm back. For me, I can hear you very well. So
now
I don't
we
know
can
if
hear
I can
you.
Continue.
Yes, we can hear you. Okay, please continue. There you go.
Okay. So I was saying that during the total lockdown, the government started quickly distributing food to those who were mostly affected, mainly starting with people who were in urban areas because they were the ones who were most affected. And then they started looking for a way how the government can make some interventions to support those who are greatly affected by the lockdown consequences. And the government now looks turned to the social protection programs. But what I can say, and what is good in Rwanda, the social protection program is now very comprehensive. After its revision in 2018, the policy and the strategy were both revised to respond to the national transformation needs. So, and it was made very much comprehensive. So it was a best alternative to help to expand social protection to those who were in the program, but also to those who were previously not in the program, but who were most hit by COVID impact. So in this, in doing this, the government put up a team of people to now develop the social protection response plan. And they were complemented by the development partners. So the development partners also formed a coordinated group. And this coordinated group were having meetings every after 2 weeks. But after realizing that the DP group was big and it couldn't really have a productive dialogue with the government, then a small group was put up to directly work with the government team. This small group was composed of UNICEF, DFID, World Bank, and the European Union. So both the small group and the bigger group were co-chaired by UNICEF and DFID. So there was a close link between the development partners and the government. So, and looking at the program, the social protection program, the government took a decision to expand social protection programs vertically and horizontally, because there were those who were affected, who were eligible for the program but were not participating, and there were those who were not eligible for the program but now who were now affected by COVID and were now in need of. Saying that the social protection program in Rwanda is comprehensive, there are safety nets and complementary programs. Laura, you had mentioned already that it's good to have social assistance, but also to adopt some graduation approaches. Already Rwanda had those two things already ongoing, because the graduation minimum package had been introduced in 2016, 15-16, and it had all those economic inclusive interventions complementing the social assistance interventions. So, and in scaling up or in expanding social protection response, it is not only the cash assistance programs that were expanded, but also the economic inclusion interventions were also expanded as well, because of course the impact of COVID was big, and we all know that cash transfers or social assistance benefit levels are always set at minimum level of survival. So this alone could not help these people survive the impact of COVID. So that's why both comprehensive economic inclusion interventions and social assistance interventions were all expanded to cover all these people, but also to allow these people who are already benefiting from cash assistance to get a diversified livelihood. So when I talk about social assistance, already there are several safety net programs. Here I can mention direct support. I can mention classic public works, expanded public works, nutrition sensitive direct support, the health insurance scheme, now even the education assistance to support with education materials and shelter. All these were also expanded. But when we go to economic inclusion, there were programs or interventions like the microcredits. These were expanded to also cover these people who are doing, were in the informal sector, but now who are affected. Then even as a complement to those who were, who are receiving the benefits of social assistance. There was the skills development to increase their employability, but this was linked to the toolkit, provision of toolkits or expansion to the benefits to people who are receiving toolkits, because already in the graduation program, the skills development was already there, and people were being trained on different skills. So they wanted to now, those who had got those skills, to get the toolkits so that they can try to look for employment elsewhere or create.
Thank you.
Yeah. So
thank you so much. Sorry, Vincent, I recognize that we are just about at time. Thank you for that overview. That's really helpful. And I think we've had several questions that have come in, and what we'll probably do, because we've had such a rich discussion with so many presenters and discussants today, we'll be able to share back some responses to the Q&A via message to everyone when we share the slides, so we can have written responses to some of the questions that are here. But maybe just in the last moment that we have, if any of the presenters would like to turn on your camera, just to answer one of the overarching questions that's come up a few times, is with regards to targeting the new poor, whether we're talking about increased numbers in urban populations, whether we're talking about overseas workers or returnees or migrants and so forth, but how you really find the best way to reach those new groups, particularly when we're thinking about expanding benefits horizontally. So if there are any of the presenters who might want to say just a very quick response to that, any techniques that have been useful so far, any lessons learned or any challenges to highlight in that space, that would be wonderful as a closing for us today.
So Lauren, I can mention just very quickly two things. So one, like I said, that self-targeting where people are opting into certain programs can be a very good way, because then this will also allow the new vulnerable groups to sort of opt in, right? And the second thing is also on the administrative side to have more rolling windows. So particularly, say in India, for example, there's a specific application window where people are supposed to apply and then they get the card. So versus that, having it more open and letting people self kind of opt in to this. So that could be one of the ways that we can explore.
Thank you, Shagun. And from any of our other presenters or discussants, do you have any comments on that targeting comment?
Laura, can I say something?
Yes, targeting? Please, Vincent. Yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry for the connection issue. But as regards targeting, I think it was easy for Rwanda because we already had a database, two databases. One is UDEHE categorization database, and we had even concluded the household profiling survey. So using those two databases, there was like triangulation of information or beneficiaries from those two databases. And then people selected in those two, from those two databases, were taken to the communities for validation. So I think this one helped because we had different sources of information, and because the impact could easily be known by people who are living with the these communities, then that's why it was taken to the communities for validation, and appeals were also being done at community level. That's what I can say. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And Mr. Kalimba or Mr. Avila, did you want to mention anything with regards to how you're identifying these new groups of beneficiaries?
Yes,
of course. Okay, Mr. Kalimba, please.
Yes, yes. I wanted just to add in terms of identification of the new poor in urban setting. I think for us, it's a challenge, because the ones that are easier to identify are the ones that are already poor. What we did was, despite not having a database, we used geographical targeting. So basically these ones are living in squatters, in slums, highly densely populated areas. So basically we assumed that those that are living in those slums are the poor. And by doing that, I think we are almost 90% correct. But otherwise, for the other new poor, it was a huge challenge, because you have to go through the associations to do with the type of livelihoods in which they are, which was a bit difficult. Thank you.
And Mr. Avila?
This has always been a challenge, and we experienced this challenge during the identification of beneficiaries of financial assistance and other social assistance during the lockdowns. I think the government is, of course, before the pandemic, has started updating the so-called listahanan, and for purposes of identifying those to be covered by social protection as services and assistance, I think once completed, this will be a good basis for determining legitimate and proper beneficiaries of the government social assistance program and other forms of assistance.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much. And I'd like to thank all of our presenters and our discussants for today. I know we had a lot that we covered, a lot of ground. I think we talked about a number of key topics here that are very pertinent for many who've joined the discussion today, whether we're talking about this topic on how do you actually reach these new poor groups or these expanded poor groups, how do you find resourcing and financing to cover this additional base, at what point in time do you integrate economic inclusion or graduation-like approaches that they'll be most effective at the outset, in the middle. If you're in the midst of the crisis, what can you do now? How do you particularly think about themes of women's labor force participation, of the reverse urban to rural spread, and whether or not that trend will actually continue, which I recognize is a question that's also come up in the Q&A as well, that I hope some of our discussants and presenters could comment on as we share back responses to this. But for today, we would like to thank everyone for your time, for your patience, and also for dealing with any of the technology issues that we might have faced. I'd like to especially thank our colleagues at socialprotection.org, Marina and Karina, for helping us to organize today, and my colleagues at BRAC, Justine and Miriam, who've been diligently working in the background here to make this a success. So thank you all very, very much for your time. In closing, we just wanted to let you know again that there are two upcoming webinars that'll take place soon. And for this particular webinar, the slide presentations, as well as some responses to Q&A questions will be shared with all of the registered attendees. So thank you very much and enjoy the rest of your mornings and afternoons. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.